Hi, this is Bobby Brown, and welcome to another fucking podcast.
You kids with your loud music and your Dan Fogelberg, your Zima, hula hoops, and Pac-Man video games, don't you see? People today have attention spans that can only be measured in nanoseconds.
See, son, old legends never die. They just lose weight.
He's like a legend and an out-of-work bum with a lot of light.
You crazy dead
fucker! Body tight!
Hello, Las Vegas. Hello, world. Hello, my loyal minions. It is good to see you, and always good to be seen. I'm Izzy Presley, and this is another effing podcast. I'm the host of the program. As you would think so, since, you know, my name's in the program. Make sure you guys check out all the social medias at Real Izzy Presley all the way across the board, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and of course the show page, Another Effin' Podcast. Got a great show for you lined up today. Something that has been a lifelong dream of mine. There was this band that I fell in love with in 1990 called Scatterbrain. And a few months back, I get a friend request from some cat named Glen Cummings. And I did math. Yes, I did math, and I realized it was the Glen Cummings from Scatterbrain. And he is on the show today. He's on the show this afternoon. He is part of this project that he was in the 90s called Stone Deep. The album that is out now is a reissue, remaster of a bunch of the stuff that Stone Deep did, and it's called Kung Fu Grip. And it is rap rock. It is rap metal. The best way to describe it is really, it's very, very much down the vein of a Stuck Mojo type thing. And it's really good. It is really good. And I only use the Stuck Mojo comparison because that gives you a starting point. And they were ahead of the curve. I mean, it started in 1992. So they are ahead of the rap rock curve. And I think you're really going to enjoy the story. And we're going to get into some Scatterbrain stuff, obviously, some Ludichrist stuff, obviously. And we're going to have a lot of fun. I think you're going to enjoy this interview. I had a goddamn blast doing it. Probably no show next week because I am going to be on the Monsters of Rock cruise. Actually, I'm going to be gone, leaving on Thursday. I get back on March 13th. So that is 2 weeks that I am gone. I'm going to try to do a show on the boat, but obviously you won't hear it till I get back. And there'll probably be no video, just audio only, because I don't have room on my phone. Whatever. Oh, before we get into the Glen Cummings interview, please, 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 if you do like the show, subscribe. Hit that subscription button right there. And we are back on Spreaker, and that is why we are not live. And it sucks not being able to do it live, but it is what it is. And this is the last time I'm going to whine about it because fucking whatever. Whatever. One part about doing it pre-recorded, I can do it when I want. You know? There's no appointment listening anymore, which sucks. But I can do it when I want. I can put out 2 shows a week, 3 shows a week if I get shit lined up, because I can record when I want, and when I want. And post it when I want, and when I want. So we'll be on the Monsters of Rock cruise. Make sure you guys check out. And Cruise to the Edge. Get my prog on, baby. Last Friday, 2 records came out. A very popular guitar player's solo, obviously Ace Frehley and Mick Mars. Ooh, let me do it over here so you can see so good. Oh, yes. Yes, I highly suggest these records. If you're going to ask me to pick between the two, sorry, Ace, the Mick Mars record is superior. But the Ace Frehley record is good as well. And probably going to have Steve Brown on the show to talk about it at some point, because Steve worked very closely with Ace, along with my good friend, close personal friend, Joey Quesada. maybe we'll get them on together. But they're on three sides this week, so I don't know. I'm going to watch the show. I'm going to watch the three sides and the shit that they don't touch on. Maybe we have Steve and Joey on to talk about it. I don't know. Okay, we'll see. I will see. Whatever. Be cool. So anyways, without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Glen Cummings, Scatterbrain, Ludichrist, Stone Deep. Enjoy. All right, and we are back, and pardon me while I go, get into my cheesy radio voice into this. Ladies and gentlemen, it's going to be big fun coming up. God, I don't know why I do that shit to myself.
So good.
Ladies and gentlemen, joining us, you know him from Scatterbrain and Ludichrist, and he has this band, or had a band called Stone Deep. His name is Glen Cummings, and he is amazing fucking guitar player. And according to Wikipedia, Glenn, Joe Satriani thought you and your partner in Scatterbrain were phenomenal.
Yeah, Paul Nieder. Yeah. I mean, thank you, Joe. Doesn't get any better than Joe Satriani, right?
He's no, like exactly.
Kind of a monster. He's a total monster.
Do you know him? Have you met him?
I've never met. I've seen him play. Strangely, and maybe this is kind of a longer story. Joe was on Joe's, two records. I can't remember what the first one was, but the second one was what? Surfing with the Alien?
Yeah.
He was on Relativity Records, and all of our Ludichrist and the first Scatterbrain were basically on Relativity, even though they were called Combat Core and then In Effect Records. It was the same company. So Steve was kind of over there, and we'd go in and steal as many copies of Steve's vinyl. Joe's kind of vinyl as possible every time we went into the offices. We were like huge fans.
No, he's a super nice guy, super humble. I do this thing. So I work on the Monsters of Rock Cruise, and he's on the Monsters of Rock Cruise this year. And I do Monsters on the Mountain. He played there a couple years ago, and I ended up in the shuttle back to the hotel from Gatlinburg to Knoxville. And I got the stern talking to from one of the gals in the office. Just so you know, you're going to be riding with Joe Satriani, so don't fuck up. I'm like, come on, honestly.
Don't bug him. He's going to take a little nap. Don't keep him awake.
Well, it was him and Don Jameson had a great conversation. I was just sitting in the back enjoying it. But so the reason that you're here, because something just came out last week. You were a part of a band called Stone Deep. And it was out of Nashville, and it was a rap rock band. And I'm just learning about this and, you know, giving it a listen. You guys were really, you started, what, 92, correct?
Yeah, 92.
And that was really at the forefront. Yeah, we had, like, Anthrax, I'm the Man, and, you know, they did the thing with Chuck D. And that was really it as far as rap rock goes, because I think Stuck Mojo was after that. Am I correct?
Yeah, probably about the same. Probably those bands like Stuck Mojo were probably about the same time.
Okay.
What
drew you to it? I mean, because obviously, you know, you come from a hard rock, heavy metal, even though you can kind of hear a little bit of the rap and Scatterbrain.
Right. Yeah, it's a kind of funny story. I mean, I grew up in Long Island, and you know, like my exposure or like my first experience, and we can talk about it later, with music was really playing in hardcore bands in New York. And that's really right around when I started going to college, which was 1983. And at the same time as the hardcore stuff was coming out, like the first super amazing rap that had like heavy beats were coming out.
Yeah.
So, you know, like Sugar Hill Gang was earlier and all that stuff, but like the early like LL Cool J and Run DMC that actually had guitars, or like LL Cool J didn't have guitars, but he had so much attitude that you kind of felt like he had guitars. So
yeah,
we were
right?
Kind of, I was kind of fan all, you know, like, or kind of a pretty extreme fan kind of from early on. And in 92, there was a kind of moment where it seemed like, was uncertain like what Scatterbrain was doing. Mm-hmm. So so I decided I had a girlfriend. Tell me if this is too long of a story.
No, please.
I had a fairly long-term girlfriend who lived in Los Angeles, and she had just moved back to Nashville where she grew up. And I went down to visit her, and after being in New York for so long, Nashville was amazing, you know. It was like all this music happening, and none of it was country music, and it was like there were like jazz bands and rock bands and crazy heavy metal bands, and everybody was going, like we were going to like concerts like 7 days a week, and beer was cheap. The bands were great, you know. And I was like, I was really thinking, well, maybe I'll just kind of move down here to Nashville, which I did. And when I kind of moved down, one of the first things that happened was I ran into these guys that had a band, and the band was called The Hardcore, CORPS. And they had a record deal with Interscope, and like they had this meteoric rise. Like they got discovered, they got signed. Jam Master Jay from Run DMC produced their record along with Phil Niccolo from the Butcher Brothers. They went straight on tour with Ice-T during the Body Count.
Oh, wow. Tour.
Then they moved and they went on tour with Primus, and they kind of were on tour with 24/7 Spies. They did a year of that, and then they got dropped by everybody. Record company, the booking agency. And it was like, what happened? So this was the exact moment I moved to Nashville. They were they were like, what happened? And they had a bunch of shows still booked, like some in Atlanta, some in Tennessee. And their guitar player was like had a real job. He was like an engineer. And when everything fell out, he said, look, I'm married, you know, I got to do this. So I was sitting in a bar, and the bass player, Kelly Butler, said, hey man, do you know anybody who could like, who's like fast enough that could fill in on some of these shows? And I said, yeah, I know somebody, me, right? Like I'm not doing anything. Yeah, right? I'm around drinking beer, like listening to music. So I kind of, I think I had something I was kind of doing. I was doing something together with Mucky Pup. Maybe it was like a record they were working on. I think I was back in New York, and then I came back down and I played a couple shows with the guys, and we had a total blast. Like we didn't even have a rehearsal. We just I learned their music on the car ride down from New York. I took notes, you know, like I had like a notepad I was like, I'm pretty sure that's A, D, F, whatever. Yeah. Listen to the CD like 15 times. And then we went and played the shows and we had a blast. We like totally hit it off. And I was like, you guys have like they just had like a chemistry, like that was super, super different than what we were doing with Scatterbrain.
Right.
And it just felt like alive and spontaneous. And we said, okay, well, let's do some songs. Let's do some recording. And initially we thought we were just going to we're going to just continue to call it The Hardcore. Mm-hmm. And we kind of make a new record and get a new label. And then when we started writing songs and we did our first session, we were like, okay, I think it's something else. And so we changed the name to Stone Deep. And we pretty much did it, did the band from 92 until, I think we took a break in 99. And then last year, like everybody else on Earth, we got back together and we started playing. We thought, are we just like a bunch of old men that like, you know, is this going to work, you know?
Yeah.
And we got together and it actually felt really good. It felt fresh. We took some old recordings and we remastered them and we put them online, like on Facebook and Instagram. And in like 3 weeks, we had like 24,000 followers.
Holy shit.
And it's like, holy shit. And, and these kind of young kids were saying stuff like, dude, how do you get like that crazy like 1990s sound? Or like,
well, ironically,
be from the 90s.
Yeah, right. Recorded in the 90s. That's how you do it. Well, you know, it's so funny that, you know, you talk about how this all came out in like 92 and, you know, didn't know what was going on with Scatterbrain. It was a real weird time in the music industry, because you had that great wall of Nirvana come down, and that not only affected, you know, 80s glam rock, as I like to call it. I hate the term hair metal, but, you know, it affected metal. It affected pop music. It affected everything. Everything changed. And so it was like, it was probably, you know, it had to be something in your mind, or like, well, fuck, what am I going to do now? Let's go see.
Right. You know, we had with I'm going to jump back and forth between bands.
Yeah, please.
We had like Scatterbrain had left In Effect Records, which was, you know, kind of part of the same family as Combat Core and Relativity. Like sort of towards the end of the arc of Here Comes Trouble, because there were two guys from Elektra Records that were like huge fans, and they were both like senior vice presidents.
Uh-huh.
And we thought, and basically we were ending the tour cycle. So basically our tour support budget and our label support, they had done a fantastic job. Steve Martin and Howie Abrams had done like an amazing job kind of pushing stuff forward, but there was like still some life left in it. And so Elektra wanted to like buy out the remainder of that option and then get our next two options. And there were all sorts of kind of like legal weirdnesses there, but we were like, yeah, okay, let's do it. So we put out one album on Elektra, and well, first we weren't sure if we should do it, right?
Uh-huh.
Because so we kind of left, and we put one album out on Elektra. That's a longer story, but basically our two senior vice presidents got fired almost like as soon as the album came out. And we were like,
now what?
So basically tour support fell off. And, and when, you know, back at that moment, everybody was selling their labels, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So even if we would have stayed at In Effect, like later that year, In Effect sold everything to, Relativity sold itself to Sony. So that whole label disappeared.
Yep.
Elektra kind of did its own kind of weird transformation. So it was like the whole thing just shrunk down. And I don't think anybody really had a context for understanding, you know, like the other guys in the band were maybe more of the mind of like, let's wait until stuff kind of settles a little bit and we can see what the landscape is. And I was more of the mind like, I got nothing to do, you know, like,
yeah, right.
So like, let's rock for like $200 a night or whatever we got to do. But like,
it's about
momentum. And that's what kind of led me to kind of head to Nashville in some ways.
Well, you know, it's so funny just to touch on that for a second is that, you know, you said the two guys from Elektra got fired. There was a lot of that happening around the industry at the time because, oh, you work with those hair bands. We don't need you. Boom, you're done. You know, like you hear that story. I think that's what happened to Tom Zutaut.
Right.
You know, it happened to a lot of guys. So yeah, that it makes sense that your guys at that time got shit canned.
Right. And they were kind of funny guys too. Like Howard Thompson, like signed like a some really a crazy range of things from like Bjork to like the Pixies and, you know, or like, there's a bunch of things too that were like, they weren't even alternative. They were just more like unusual groups that they were just like, you know, it was like old school A&R, like hire the weird band and then just support them through 20 years and they'll do amazing stuff.
Yeah.
Except we sort of got like maybe a year out of it
before
they kind of went.
Yeah. Right. Right.
Before their unconditional love just sort of, you know, like the whole economic world changed. So,
right.
You know, it wasn't their fault. It was like more corporate.
Yeah, for sure. So the Stone Deep thing. So you said you guys got together about a year ago. Were you out playing gigs again? Or were you just kind of jamming?
Well, I mean, so yeah, part of the funny part is like everybody else is still in Nashville,
uh-huh.
and I wound up in New York. So we made a couple weekends where I go down to Nashville and like we'd run through songs and build back some of the repertoire, have dinner and talk and stuff.
Yeah.
And then after like two times, then we're like, okay, we probably should do promo photos next time. And then we probably should start shooting videos. And then we figured we would remaster and re-release. The funny thing is we made like 5 albums during that 9-year stint. Uh-huh. And one of them got like acknowledged by the Grammy Foundation as like best independent recording from 1996. We won every regional award we could kind of win in Nashville, and there were a lot. So it was like regionally we've kind of had this incredible success, but like nobody outside of like Nashville or Kentucky, Tennessee actually heard anything. So we thought, okay, let's put some of this stuff out again and just see. Like, so once we started doing that, we just started getting momentum. Then we started playing a couple gigs, and so we've been gigging, but only in Nashville.
Okay.
Well, Nashville and Memphis.
I love totally. Memphis.
Yeah.
I love Memphis when you stay in the decent parts of Memphis. When you get behind Elvis Presley Boulevard. Yeah.
Right. It's like saying I love New Orleans, and you're like, which part of New Orleans?
Yeah, exactly.
Some parts that are still really, really struggling, you know.
Well, I suppose, I mean, it's like, you know, I equated to, there was an 80s band out of Minneapolis called Slave Raiders. I'm from Minneapolis, and they were big in the upper Midwest, but it was pre-internet. It was pre, and like you guys, they were on the Headbangers Ball or whatever, and they were on a License to Drive soundtrack, but that's really the height of where they went. You know, they were a regional band, and it kind of sounds like Stone Deep was the same thing.
Yeah.
Especially because it's pre-internet. You know, do you think it could have been different had it been internet times?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I think maybe, because at that point we were still really really trying to, like, we did everything ourselves, right? We kind of we did our own recording sessions. We put out our own release, and we booked our own tours. We made our own merchandise. We basically did everything, and but we still kind of had the idea that eventually at some point we would get a label involved, and we get at least enough financial support to like build out a team.
Yeah.
And that just sort of like it wasn't where the rest of the music world was. And so we had a great time doing it ourselves. And then, you know, as the guys got a little bit older, everybody started getting married and having kids, and it's like, oh, okay, well, let's put it on hold for a while, you know, but now it's kind of been fun to go back to it. In some ways, the music sounds, well, here's what this is really funny. When we were playing the same music back in the 90s, people used to say, oh, this music, it's over. Like your style. And we're like, well, what style is that exactly?
Yeah.
This style, it's over. Said, okay. And then when we started just playing again, people were like, oh, this sounds fantastic. So it's like the things that were over 25 years ago.
Right.
Are not over anymore. I guess they're not, they weren't actually over. They just weren't of that moment.
Well, that's always how the cycle seems to go. It's always after 20 years, that's when the comeback comes, you know? Because then the early 2000s, that's when the 80s stuff started coming back.
And, right.
You know, 70s and the 90s, it's like, boom, it's like clockwork.
Right. It's literally like clockwork. It's amazing. Well, and so many great bands are back, you know, which is fantastic. Yeah.
Well, and like, and even with like the resurgence of Limp Bizkit, you know, even though it's a different style inside the same style, you know, it's got to help a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, it's fantastic, and like all of us have kind of friends in different bands and things over the years from touring. So you know, it's great to see those folks kind of like friends and people whose music we love, like out there kind of doing it, and hopefully we'll connect to do some shows together with some of those acts along the way too.
How close did you guys come though, as far as like to possibly getting a label and all that stuff?
You know, I mean, we allegedly had label deals like six times, you know, like there were different, you know, it's like people call up,
yep.
they got the recordings. They loved it. They came in, they saw a show, they were blown away. We set another time for them to come see more shows. There was a phone call where they said they're hoping to get support from the rest of the team. That's always the secret keyword, and then things would kind of peter out. So it really happened like five or six times. After, you know, the first three times we were like, okay, when we're like sending stuff, and then the last two times we were like, okay, well, you just come, we're playing and just come on down and stay at my house and, you know, see the gigs. And the band was always fantastic live. And because it was Nashville in the 90s, the studios were, and still are, you know, like world class.
Yeah.
And basically, you know, the people who are kind of working on the high end projects, like the Garth Brooks records or whatever, they weren't necessarily country fans. They were audio fans.
Right.
Fidelity fans.
Yeah.
And so it was very easy. Like there were some really great, great guys. We worked with a guy named Mike Griffiths who had like tons and tons of hits, and another guy named Rob Earls who had his own studio for years. And they were both like world-class guys, and they'd be like, yeah, we've got plenty of empty studio time. Let's work out a deal. And, you know, it was fantastic. It was very easy to live and kind of make music and record in Nashville at that point.
Yeah. Nashville was cheap then.
Yes, it was.
I mean, especially compared to New Yorker. I mean, I was in LA for 8.5 years too. It's like, and that's where everybody, they're going to Nashville, or I'm in Vegas now, or Austin, which is basically turning into LA, right. You know.
Well, I remember going from New York and we went to Nashville, and I was splitting an apartment with my girlfriend, and I think we had a nice like two bedroom apartment. I think like, I don't know, maybe it was like $600 a month. And we were outraged that we were paying so much. So we bought a house. We bought a house like really close to downtown because the mortgage on the house
was cheaper than rent.
Would only be around $300 a month.
Holy shit.
And it was way cheaper than rent. So we were like, why are we paying so much for rent when we could just pay half the price for kind of a mortgage?
And of course, now you're thinking, God, I should have held on to that house. Oh, exactly, I should have held on to that house.
Yeah, and in the early 2000s, like real estate, like houses that were like $30,000 houses became like $400,000 houses, you know, just like in like 2 years. It was like insane. So people who invested in real estate in Nashville and everywhere across the U.S. had a real bump there.
Yeah, well, I saw that. I don't remember the TV show Scrubs, but like I follow the guy that played the Todd, and and he's like he's a real estate guy. And I just saw him; he was all proud. He sold a condo, which means he sold an apartment for $900,000 in Santa Monica, and it's probably the size of my apartment here.
That's right, exactly. That's exactly what it is.
Oh,
yeah, there was an article last year, maybe about a year and a half, that in New York, that the median apartment in New York hit $1 million an apartment. Now, most median doesn't mean the average, right? It just means like if there's 1,000, you basically take the one in the middle, and what does that cost? But most apartments are one bedroom apartments. There's only like a very, you know, like the very few apartments like in certain parts of town that are two or three bedroom apartments. Because who can afford them, right?
It's just insane. I mean, I live on the Strip, and I'm paying $1,100 a month.
Huh? Not too bad.
Vegas, baby. Vegas. Yeah. But Vegas is starting to get out of control too. So you're gonna do some gigs. You're gonna have some fun. That's kind of what you're doing with Stone Deep right now.
Yeah, we've been having a great time. We released a new album called Kung Fu Grip. that's well, new album, a remastered version mm-hmm. of the album we put out in 96. And in some ways, it's kind of my favorite album because we kind of switched from like guitar, bass, drums, DJ, vocal. Like uh-huh. our DJ second vocalist got just busy with work and things. So we had this like stripped down version of the band. And it was like a super energized time. So I think the album's really, really great. It's like on all the streaming services now.
Yeah, that's the way to do it.
And we'll play some gigs this fall. I mean, this spring. Sorry, wrong time of year.
Yeah, that's right. Old. That's right. Yeah.
And we'll have a great time.
So we got to talk Scatterbrain. We got to talk a little Scatterbrain. So Scatterbrain originally started out as Ludichrist. Is that the gist of it?
Well, there's kind of funny story around it because, you know, like at the time, the second Ludichrist album, it didn't really sell very well. Mm-hmm. And so there were a lot of like, it's this weird thing in the world of music that if you have one album that doesn't sell, it's very hard to kind of jumpstart the next one.
Yeah.
So we had written the whole third Ludichrist album. And tell me if I'm going into too much detail.
No. The more the gooder.
And it's just around the time when Howie Abrams and Steve Martin had been charged with, you know, heading up this new version or this new imprint inside Relativity called In Effect. And they had already put together like it was like Agnostic Front, 24/7 Spies, Nuclear Assault, Limbo Maniacs, some other things they kind of moved over there. And we knew Howie from shows. We didn't really know Steve, but Steve had previously played in Agnostic Front and he was like also like a pretty savvy promo guy. And so Howie and Steve came out to like some rehearsals. Like I think there was a big question mark whether the label even wanted to make the third Ludichrist album. Mm-hmm. Like this is like, and so we were like, okay. Because let me tell you, the album budgets weren't really, you know, it's like, like you could have afforded to be the record label for the
well, for the second let's not get ahead of ourselves record. Here.
Right.
That's funny.
Like I could have, or whatever.
Yeah.
Like we could get like five guys in any bar together and fund the second Ludichrist record. So there wasn't a lot of money at stake.
Yeah.
So Howie and Steve came down to see the rehearsals to say, what the hell are these guys doing anyway? And they both kind of loved the new material. And so they started kind of like coming to rehearsals. It was the first time we kind of had an A&R presence at all.
Uh-huh.
And we went through, I mean, we can go back to this, but in more detail in how we developed the songs and recorded them up at Normandy Sound with Tom Soares. And we got through the whole thing. I think we even had artwork underway. And Howie and Steve were like, we're running into all sorts of promotional blockades already. We think like this is an incredible album and we're going to sort of get cock blocked out of the start with it being a Ludichrist album. So we said, okay, like what are we talking about? They said, well, if you shift the name, like that kind of frees up a lot of the problems. So the record company held a contest to rename us. And there's,
that's awesome.
And the entries are like, they're absolutely hysterical. You know, they're like, everyone is X-rated and kind
of course.
More absurdist than the next. In the end, I don't think I think we gave somebody a prize and then we just picked the name Scatterbrain and we just like became Scatterbrain. So then since the story was that basically the story became like it was a new band because that was part of like how we could break from the previous thing.
Right.
But if you go back to videotapes or even like search YouTube, you're going to see all these Ludichrist videos where we're playing Don't Call Me Dude and and all the songs from the new Ludichrist album. which is pretty funny.
Were you doing the costumes and all that shit in Ludichrist?
That's a good question. You know, we weren't because we well, with the first record, I mean, you have to remember this is like 1985, 86. So touring was a lot more rough and like hard. Like the first album, we were considered a hardcore band, which meant we mostly played in storage spaces, like,
right.
You know, billiard halls, people's parents' house. We slept in clubs. We slept in the van. You know, so we toured a good amount, but it was really rough and ready. And by the second album, the world, like the music world, was getting more like crossover. Basically, there was like heavy metal stuff meeting hardcore stuff.
Yeah.
And so the shows tended to be like there was more concentration in like bigger venues. So we would go and actually play real venues on that tour. But it was like, we'd have like five shows in a row, and then we'd come home for 2 weeks, and then we'd have another five. Then we'd drive to like Michigan and like play like six shows kind of in a row. Like we weren't really like, we didn't really have proper tours except for a European run. And I think the costumes only really started when we had like months of five shows a week or six shows a week as a way to just stay.
Stay entertained. I mean, let's be honest. You can't really wear a chicken outfit in a hardcore show in the corner of a billiard hall. It would rule.
We the precedent for me always was I was always a big MDC, Millions of Dead Cops fan, and we played with them in Berlin before the wall came down, right? So it was like heavy, crazy police presence. It was like military zone. And in this giant squat, we played a show together with MDC. And I hadn't seen them in years. And Dave Dichter, the singer, we were like hanging out backstage. I gotta get ready to play. Kind of like, he dresses up in this Elvis costume. I'm just going, what the hell is going on? Like MDC, like such an intense act. I'm like, why the hell is he dressing up like Elvis? Like, it's not like what was that band? It was a band in like the
Dred Zeppelin, yeah.
Right. Doing the hey, like reggae kind of Elvis Zeppelin tune. And it was the same thing. Like Dave is just like, they're just like keeping the absurd spirit alive, like doing whatever they're gonna do. And I always felt like that was like an extension of Tommy's move into the chicken suit, and there are many chicken suit stories, but the nun suit, the chicken suit.
Yeah. Do you think that stuff might have hurt you in the long run?
You know, that's a good question.
Well, I mean, you look at the videos, you look at, you know, obviously you've seen the live stuff of the band. And it's just all this ridiculous, absurd, funny, awesome stuff going on. But do you think like you got maybe put into, oh, they're just a comedic band, fucking whatever, they'll go away?
Yeah, that's a good point. Like, I mean, I think it's a really good question. I was on some video thing. I did a kind of interview thing and together with Howie Abrams. And Howie, who is like the record company guy during Here Comes Trouble at In Effect. And Howie said, yeah, you know, you guys, you actually just never had an image, you know, like even when you were Ludichrist, like you're just like guys that rolled out of bed and got on stage in sweatpants or like, you know, like whatever. And I think we were kind of really into that. Like we were really into not, like we were just, we were into not, you know, like not having any barrier in between, like we're just like guys in the audience who like got on stage and kind of played it. And Howie was saying, well, I'm not sure that like ever kind of worked in your favor, like because people you know, it's like now people would say, oh, that's like the look is no look, right?
Yeah.
But like at that point, like 1985 or 1986, 87, that what, like somehow the world didn't get that yet. Yeah. And then if you take that forward into the chicken suit or like pigtails or kind of, yeah, you know, yeah, wearing dresses or whatever. I think, yeah, I think in some ways, there was still a music business expectation, mm-hmm, that you would have that your image would be sensational in some ways that wasn't like a fuck you, right? Yeah. I think our presence, whether it was silly or whatever, was always sort of like a fuck you to the whole thing.
Yeah.
Like listen to the music because he's in a chicken suit and and I'm a nun and Paul's where, you know, he's in his underwear because he just is. I don't even know why. So yeah, I think like in some ways, like a whole portion of the world probably just said, oh yeah, I don't like that. What is that? And then I think there's a whole other section that got it because that was the,
yeah,
like a good example is at some point we got a phone call and we thought it was a prank phone call from this promoter in Australia, and he said, hey, you guys have a he said, I'm gonna forget the guy's name, he said, yeah, this is blah blah blah, and you guys have a number three hit in Australia, I want to fund a tour, you know, like a month long or month and a half tour in Australia. And he said, Mom, is that you?
Yeah, right.
You know,
right.
Like, well, who is this? You know. And the funny thing is, the whole no image lobster suit as image.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Thing, like it just 100% connected in Australia, and people are like, "Yeah, fuck that image shit." Like, I want to see a band where somebody's dressed like a giant hot dog and everybody else has a sunburn because they fit, you know, like, and like it just like made sense, like the whole piss take on everything made sense. Yeah. And the music kind of made the beat, like Don't Call Me Dude was that, and then the visuals were that too. And it's so funny, but in the United States, we had a lot of support from like Ricky Rackman or MTV, yeah, and kind of like various radio stations in different cities. But in general, yeah, I think what you're saying, like that people didn't know what to do with that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think Scatterbrain though was very ahead of their time. Not just for the theatrics, but I mean, like, you take a song like Goodbye Freedom, Hello Mom. Right. And it's almost like that's what's going on nowadays. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it seems like it could be a contemporary song, right?
Yeah, right.
No matter where you fall on the political spectrum, moving from the model of, I mean, people literally, like people who talk about like critical economic theory literally use those terms like big mother, instead of big brother, because it's become like a, like manners and kind of these other things, which used to be more free of a kind of free zone, are kind of more a politicized thing at the moment.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's like, you know, I was just listening to the record again for the, you know, first time in a while. And it's like, oh fuck, this shit, it's relevant. It's fucking relevant. It's all relevant again. God bless Scatterbrain.
It's the 30-year thing again, exactly, coming back at us. Like,
exactly. Obviously, then the Cheech and Chong. That was a beautiful choice. Was that something you guys were doing live and just decided to do it on the record, or was that like, oh fuck, we love this? Or you were high as fuck watching Cheech and Chong, said fuck it, we got to do this on the record.
Well, there's certain songs we kind of always loved, you know, and I feel like as the album or as the other songs kind of took shape, I think we kind of added in Cheech, you know, like that. It was the kind of Alice Bowie scene in
Up in Smoke,
where Cheech Marin is like, he's in the tutu, you know, and he's like got like some crazy mask on and he's doing some stage moves. But like the song is like the song, the riff is brutal, yeah. You know? So it's like this thing that's like a complete joke, but then it's kind of awesome at the same time. And we thought, yeah, that's like somebody wrote a song for us, you know? Yeah. It's like, that's our song, you know? Right. Right. In some ways, it's the same as like the early, you know, we used to do a bunch of classical tunes and people say, oh, were you kind of like a Mozart fan or a Rossini fan? And it's like, we're like Bugs Bunny fans, you know? Like the moment where Bugs Bunny is like massaging Elmer Fudd's head.
Yes,
he's pretending to be a barber.
Yep.
And he's like, and he's going doom, 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 doom. Like, I think we watched that like a million times and like fell on the floor laughing like a million times and be like, that's what music should be, right?
Right.
Like in some ways, Carl Stalling, who did the, you know, he's kind of a completely underrated musical genius because he's thought to be a cartoon soundtrack guy.
Yeah, yeah.
And he was like, he's more influential than Stockhausen or any kind of, you know, like concrete composer or anybody who, John Cage or people like who took those same concepts more to in a highbrow way. So yeah, Cheech and Chong.
Cheech and Chong to fucking Sonata. I mean, what more do you need?
Yeah, Cheech and Chong was brilliant. We had history of weird cover songs. Like Ludichrist did the first Ludichrist album. We did Last Train to Clarksville.
Really?
And the reason was, I think I knew the Last Train to Clarksville riff, but we, it's not much of a reason, but we thought it would just be funny as hell to like play songs from a TV band.
Yeah.
You know, like they weren't even a real, like the Monkees were, you know, like, you know, they were like the Partridge Family. So we thought, yeah, yeah, that's kind of what we are. We're like the Monkees or like the Partridge Family. And then I can't remember. We did some weird stuff on, the Rossini's actually on the second Ludichrist album, which is my which I always liked better than the Mozart. Although we got better at playing when we got up to the Mozart.
Yeah, and, yeah, a little bit.
There's also this very weird take that's probably only on the bonus version of Power Trip. It's called Girl from Iwo Jima. And we used to, like, when we had nothing to do or we were waiting for Tommy to finish his cigarette in between songs, we would, like, whatever song we heard on the radio, we would do a version of, we would just play it like we were playing a real song. And that was, like, one of the tunes. Like, I guess we were in Florida, we were in Tampa, and we thought it was really funny. Like, I mean, the song was probably popularized by Bebel Gilberto.
Is right, right. Well, actually, you know the most famous thing it's in? When Jake and Elwood are in the elevator, that's the music. And actually, when you listen to this show, the intro, right after the intro ends, that elevator version is behind me as I'm talking.
I love it. I love it. Absolutely love it. Yeah, I mean, kind of, we really loved like movie bands and like TV bands. We thought that was like amazing.
Well, it really works with what you guys did, you know? It just did. I mean, with the whole presentation, it's like, fuck it. Movie and TV shit. Why not? No, I love it, dude. And I'm going to tell you this. This is really cool. So when, you know, we discovered the band, me and my friend Jeff Coldis, and going, it was probably the summer before, because it was 1990, and we bought the CD. And in the CD, there was this merch card. So we ordered T-shirts. Now, we thought we were being smart by not getting the Don't Call Me Dude shirt, because we went to a Catholic high school and everybody's a dick. And all we're getting, hey, dude. So we got the white one with the Scatterbrain orange thing on it, right? And now I regret not getting the Don't Call Me Dude shirt. But when Big Fun was coming out, you guys sent me a package that had an autographed photograph, this a whole bunch of press clippings, and the Big Fun CD single. It's like, that is the coolest thing ever. You made a awesome. CD. You made a kid's day.
Yeah, I always felt like, you know, I mean, I was like, I grew up like, we're like getting stuff, like getting music stuff was like a big deal, you right. know? Like if you got stickers, like you think about it, you just think about it for weeks, like put it on like whatever you loved most and like play the album over and over again, staring at the artwork.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, maybe it's like being an old person now. And it's like back in the day when we had lots of free time, like we were kind of, like music just was like basically everything.
Yeah. Know? Well, I mean, like that's one of the reasons that I was such a Kiss geek, because right. all the shit that you got, there's this right. band out of Minneapolis, Flip. Same thing. It's like Kiss meets the Sex Pistols meets Cheap Trick. It's like the same fucking thing, you know? And I just wanted to take a chance to personally thank you for that, because that's cool.
You're more than welcome. You know, for years, it really wasn't until like the Scamboogery moment where we started to have somebody else do merchandise. I started doing the Ludichrist t-shirts probably right at the beginning, 85. Uh-huh. Tommy had designed like the little logo. It's like Christ with punk rock hair and praying hands. And then after that, he was busy with other stuff. So I'd make flyers and t-shirts. And when we changed to Scatterbrain, we just kind of made all sorts of crazy stuff. I think at some point we got, it was either Tommy's mom or my mom that would do the fulfillment. You know, it was basically we'd send it to this address, and at yeah. some point it was all going to Tommy's house, and at some point it came to my house. And there was a really funny part where I guess we were on MTV and like we were popular, and so there were like a range of fans who were women who would like send naked pictures, or they would send like sexy pictures to themselves to the band, and my mom would open them up and like answer the so like when we got back from tour
that's awesome.
There would be this pile of envelopes, you know, like there would be like the answered yeah. mail, and I'd look through them and there would be like some sexy note, and then there would be like, I think she used to make photocopies of what she, because people use photocopies of her reply, and there would be like some sexy note, and then she'd be like, "Dear Francine, thank you for your lovely picture and for being such a loyal fan to the band. I'm enclosing 6 stickers. Hope you enjoy them and use them to cover whatever you need to cover."
Oh, Jesus Christ. Mom, I can have sex. What are you doing? This is road trip. Do you still talk to the guys?
I talked to Guy a bit because he's more like online.
Uh-huh.
Tommy's kind of just seems to be busy with the things. He's not a kind of digital person. So I haven't talked to him in like many, many years. Guy I talk to occasionally because he's sort of like the Guy's like part owner in a music store okay. out in Long Island. So he's kind of like out and about and kind of talking to people all the time. So he's sort of like the mouthpiece that's like available to talk for the other guys. And Paul I chatted with online, but I haven't spoke to him in person in a long time.
Okay. Do you remember the last time you guys were in the same room as a band?
Like playing? Or yeah. just kind of
or,
in the same
or just,
place?
Just in the same place.
Well, when the guys played their first reunion thing, they played a show here in New York at BB King's. And I kind of went to go, it didn't line up with my schedule, but I went to go see them play. And so that's the last time we were in the same place. But the last time we played, honestly, it had to be like, I was trying to go through the listing of shows and figure out when the last show that I played was, and I still haven't figured it out, because it might have been at Streets up in New Rochelle, or I'm not exactly sure. I think I was living in Nashville. I came back to play one show, and then there was a, then I lost track of what the guys were doing. And I, they might've like taken a break for a while, and then they put it, they got it, things moving again, and put another album together that they kind of released. And I think there was a bunch of shows to support it, but that's the one part of Scatterbrain history that I'm the most blurry. Well, I'm blurry on many things, but the, I'm the most blurry on that.
Well, I suppose if you weren't on it.
Yeah, that would.
You know, has there been any talk about, I mean, you guys brought the idea up about doing a Scatterbrain show here and there?
Well, it's, I guess it's like the 30 or what is it? 35th? Oh my God. Is that right?
Yeah,
35th anniversary.
35th next year, yeah.
Right. So, it, so guys brought it up a couple times. You know, like if there's some kind of some, but there would have to be like some reason to, for everybody. I don't think anybody is like opposed to it, but I don't think there's anything concrete planned to do it. There isn't, there's another like unreleased set of demos that it basically was the album we were working on when we got dropped from Elektra.
Okay.
So there's like 12 songs, 12 Scatterbrain songs that nobody's ever heard. So there was some discussion about trying to get it together and kind of do a real release of that. And then, but it's all kind of just speculative at this moment.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's cool. Glenn, what do you do now?
That's a good question. After I, well, what I do now is I run a design studio. So okay. I have a design studio, design all sorts of stuff. And I do some teaching at in New York at a school called Pratt Institute, which is like a art slash design school. And that's kept me busy. Like after I moved to Nashville, I basically worked as a musician, like my own thing. And then I would pick up gigs like playing for other bands or whatever to pay the bills. And then after a while, I started working in publishing and then advertising. Then I moved to I moved from Nashville to Chicago, and I worked in design in Chicago. And then I went to grad school on the East Coast, and then I moved to New York in 2002, and I've kind of been doing design stuff since.
When you were in Nashville, did you try to get on with one of those bigger bands? Like in Nashville, because look, a lot of those guys are rock players.
Man, there's a lot of good guitar. Like,
yeah, was, but you're in that echelon. I mean, dude, you're that fucking good.
I would say going to Nashville to play like play guitar is like going to like Alaska to like shovel snow. It's like like the people that are there actually, like the country players actually are really really good.
They're
rock
the
players.
Best. They're the best.
They're super good players.
Yeah,
and okay, I have I have an anecdote from when I first moved to Nashville. I had a problem with my car. So like, I was like, where can I go to like, and so, and we like a friend of a friend was like, go to this guy, he's good. So like down some street, whatever, middle of nowhere, dirt road, some guy, you know, he's in overalls, whatever. It's like, I'll fix your car. So I'm like, he's like, yeah, let me, give me like half an hour. Just hang around. Like, let me take a look at it. I'm like, okay. So he's like looking at the car. I walk around the block or something. I come back and he's like, yeah, I can fix it. It's going to be like $50 and whatever. And I'm like, okay. And he's like, what do you do? I'm like, I'm a musician. He's like, oh, that's cool. You play? He's like, I got a guitar over here. I'm like, oh, that's cool. You play a little bit? He's like, not really. I don't really play that much. And I'm like, okay. So as I'm like counting my money up, he picks up the guitar. He was an incredible, like a world-class guitar player. Like, but like everybody was.
So this is a true story.
Yeah, this is just like the
holy shit.
Like the just standard random guy on the street was like a good, like a totally solid guitar player who could also sing, could also whatever. And almost everybody is. So the problem is, you know, if you're a studio guy or you're like touring guys are different than studio guys.
Yeah.
And so touring guys, like they have their gig, they're out on the road like 3-4 months a year, 5 months a year. or two different runs. Mm-hmm. And then basically they just have their own little bands that play and their, yep, their side gigs. The studio guys, there's like 10 studio guys. It's always those guys.
Yep, they play on everything.
And they're fucking monsters. And like, so the gigs that are available, like for a New York guitar player are, you know, like you can play with a bunch of bands and hope that some of those bands go, but it's much harder to like get like a pickup.
Yeah. Oh, that makes sense. Gig.
I mean, I sat in with a kind of bunch of people. The stuff that I did were like tended to be more with like guys that I knew, like Mucky Pup would need a guitar player, like go out on tour with them for a month here or there when we weren't so busy. And mm-hmm. we had a blast, you know. It's super fun playing other, you know, in other people's setup.
Yeah. Well, dude, that's why I do the Ace Frehley tribute thing. You know, I play 2-3 times a year. I get to play Kiss songs with my friends and get paid for it.
It's amazing.
Did you ever fall into the Kiss geekdom being a New York kid?
I was always a kid. I mean, I grew up like a Kiss fan. I mean, I feel like I had every Kiss album, and like even when I was, you know, I think of like hanging around with my friends in grade school, we would put Kiss records on and like jump, you know, totally jump around there, whoever's house, like imitating, you know, the songs on Kiss Alive 1 and then yep. Kiss Alive 2. And, you know, it was like, we just kind of stayed. And I guess I was a Kiss fan. I really followed pretty closely through maybe Animal Eyes. Maybe I saw the Animal Eyes. I mean, I saw them a bunch of times.
Yeah.
I think Animal Eyes, they played Radio City Music Hall and we went to go see them.
That would have been with Queensryche opening.
Sounds right.
Yeah.
That sounds right.
I'm a dork. I know these things.
That's amazing. Yeah. And they were great. And then I just got I never stopped being a Kiss fan. I just kind of got dragged into other stuff that was more like.
I always say that we as Kiss fans, we are the Scientologists of rock and roll. I mean, you think about it. We worship these gods from outer space. They take all of our money. And if you say anything bad about them, we will cut you. The only difference is Scientologists do not talk about Scientology. Kiss fans never shut the fuck up.
Space, space, space. I mean, I was always looking. I mean, who isn't an Ace Frehley fan? Exactly. I met Ace Frehley once, only once, for like 13 seconds. We were at some point. I had a guitar endorsement. We were endorsing. I was endorsing Paul Reed Smith guitars.
Okay.
And Paul would do this thing where he would go to New York, and he had his like combo, which were like, you know, some guys who were session players, and they'd play like the Hard Rock Cafe for like one or two nights and invite people up. And they were like, hey, come down and play, like, you know, like sit in for a song or two, like a blues song. It's like Ace Frehley's invited. Ace Frehley says he's coming. I'm like, holy shit. I could like be on
like stage with
music
Ace.
In yep. the mix with Ace Frehley. That would be like amazing. So like everybody's hanging around, and like eventually the band's like, okay, whatever, we're playing. Got to sit in with those guys. They're really super nice guys and amazing. And then everybody like cleaned up and like had their extra drinks and like moved their stuff out, right? And I was just like, I can't remember what it was. I had somewhere to be like later, like much later at night. So I was like hanging around. Everybody had left. And I was like, all right, I'll get the fuck out of here. And I was walking towards the door, and this guy comes in. Hey, man, where's the fucking band?
Hey, where's the fucking band?
And I was like, you mean the band that like stopped like 2.5 hours ago? He's like, oh, this place, you know, this is so stupid. Like, this place sucks or something. What is everybody playing in the afternoon for? You know, it was already like 2 a.m.
Yeah.
I was ever playing a fucking afternoon.
I was like, well, they're gone. And he was like, all right, thanks, buddy. And I was like, hey, I met Ace Frehley.
Yeah. Oh my God. That is a perfect place to end. Glen, I could keep talking to you for hours. thank you so much for doing this. This has been an absolute pleasure. Make sure you check out Stone Deep. Hit them up on all of the streaming services. And the album's out now. It's Kung Fu Grip. Thank you.
I'm a fucking pro. I mean, whatever.
It's been a pleasure, man. It's so good to hang with you. Let's do it again.
Please, man. You are welcome. Anytime we do one of these Kiss shows, we'll get you on and have some fun.
Oh, please, man. I love it.
That'd be fucking great. Glen Cummings, everybody. Yeah. Well, there you go, kids. Glen Cummings, Scatterbrain, Ludichrist, and Stone Deep. Make sure you guys check out the latest Stone Deep remastered, reissued Kung Fu Grip stuff from the 90s. It is very cool. You will thoroughly enjoy it. And yeah, I had a blast. Glen Cummings, what a great guy. I could have sat and talked to him for a couple more hours at least. I hope he gets out here to Nashville, Las Vegas at some point. We can sit down and have beverages and have a good old time. Maybe get him in the studio. But he has to come to Las Vegas first for it to happen. Be back in a couple weeks. Obviously, I leave on Thursday for the Monsters of Rock Cruise, which I am a host on every year. Not a Trump-level host, but I am there. God damn it. I am there. Love you, Ed. Can't wait to see you. Can't wait to see everybody. It's going to be a blast.
Ace Frehley's on the phone. I can't wait.
And so there, cruising the edge. I get back on the 13th and hopefully post a show that I recorded on the Monsters of Rock Cruise. We'll see. Maybe it'll happen. Maybe it'll happen. All right. Love you guys. I say good day.